Good evening. Welcome to the National Indoor Arena here in Birmingham on day two of the Network Q RAC Rally. Another day of snow and ice, and just as he did at this stage last year, the Flying Scot, Colin McRae, has made all the headlines in the snowy forests of Wales. He's now in the lead, 21 seconds ahead of the world champion, Juha Kankkunen. It's been a good day too for Malcolm Wilson, Britain's other rallying star. He's moved up to third spot. The 146 surviving cars left Birmingham this morning and headed for Wales. 10 icy and treacherous stages. Barrie Gill takes up the story.
Wales was not keeping a very warm welcome for the 146 survivors, but rally leader Juha Kankkunen was not only undaunted, but soon demonstrating in devastating style just why he is world champion. He was a full 13 seconds faster than his closest pursuer, Britain's Malcolm Wilson, and 47 seconds faster than Colin McRae, who now find himself 1 minute, 4 seconds behind the leader. Kankkunen's co-driver, Nicky Grist, was obviously enjoying this flying visit to his Welsh homeland.
120. Okay.
I see you've got a little bit of body damage on the left-hand side. What happened there?
Yeah, it was just one slow corner and was icy on the braking, like the whole stage. But I just, there were some logs, not logs, but just cutty trees hanging side of the road, and I just touched them a little.
Meanwhile, the Mitsubishi team, the unexpected stars of the first day, had had far more serious problems. Arvin Schwartz slumped from second to 77th place after 16 minutes in a ditch, and Kenneth Erickson dropped from 3rd to 11th. Roger Clark's son, Matthew, was having a tough RAC baptism. He probably couldn't believe it when David Llewellyn caught up with him. The Welshman was 8th fastest overall in the front-wheel drive Formula 2 Astra.
I must say that at least the surface was the same all the way through anyway, even though there was no grip at all.
I don't think there's any words to describe it. It's absolutely treacherous.
Gwyndab had a word.
Diabolic.
What does that mean?
I don't think I should say that in English.
Daylight saw a dramatic fight back by Kenneth Erickson, fastest over both the Meyerhirth and the Hafren stages. He was now 8th. Malcolm Wilson had been in trouble from the very start of the day. His Ford wouldn't start in the overnight car park, but he was 2nd fastest on 2 of the first 3 stages, promoting himself to 5th position.
Flat press 30, cut right max, and absolute left over crest 80. Flat left 70, turn fast, K left long. Flat right 40.
Colin McRae was now in his stride and determined to close the gap on Kankkunen. A 3rd fastest time on Meyerhirth was enough to slot him happily into 2nd place. Francois Delacour in the Lone Works Ford moved confidently up to 6th place, while his rival and compatriot Didier Auriol took 3rd place with consistently fast times. This was at the expense of Ari Vatanen, who lost 20 seconds with a spin on Hafren. British champion Richard Burns was finding his Subaru a handful in treacherous conditions. Just watch him battling with the ice. His teammate, Alistair McRae, modified his car's appearance, and this called for some heavy-handed cosmetic surgery.
I'm afraid it's a bit second-hand now. Just on the second stage this morning, we had a puncture, and we had to drive 7 miles on, and we think, we're not 100% certain, but we think maybe something's been broken in the back that we haven't seen. and just braking very hard from a sixth gear straight into a fifth gear left-hander, the car just started to steer towards the trees and I couldn't do anything about it.
Quindaf Evans, after giving us a lesson in rudimentary Welsh, was in textbook form as he built up a dominant group end lead. His rivals had a host of problems. Harry Mockinan fell far of a puncher. And Cumbrie and Dougie Watson-Clark had a very lucky escape.
Taking it a bit easy because of the ice and everything like that, and then the stage cleared and we started having a bit of a go. Everything was going to plan, not a problem, and unfortunately we were just coming up a hill very, very fast and it just tightened a bit too tight to the left, and unfortunately we rolled off into the undergrowth. As it happened, there was an awful lot of spectators there, rolled us back onto the track again. But we've bent the car quite bad, so whether we're going to carry on or not, I don't know. As you can see, the car's quite badly damaged. But although it still runs all right, it's whether the organisers will let us carry on.
In the Formula 2 category, Welshman David Llewellyn was pleasing his home crowd with a most commanding performance in the Astra. And he must have been cheered by the news that Grégoire de Mavius had been halted by engine failure in his Nissan. Manxman Mark Higgins was now his main challenger in another Astra, while Skoda's Pavel Sibera had failed to come to grips with the conditions and literally slipped from 26th to 47th.
So by the end of stage 12, Colin McRae, who'd fallen over a minute behind Kankanen early in the day, had fought his way into second place to cut the deficit by about 20 seconds. Now, Kankanen's teammate Oriel in third spot led Vatanen here, and Malcolm Wilson, thanks to those two second fastest times, held fifth position, with Britain's young champion Richard Byrne showing his talent on the world stage in seventh place. So, Colin McRae poised to attack Kankanen at this stage. The big question now, could the Scot narrow the gap on the world champion? And could the other Brit in form, Malcolm Wilson, continue his charge up the field?
Juha Kankanen was still out in front, but must have been all too aware that Colin McRae was menacing right behind him. On the next two stages, the champion faltered slightly, recording only fourth and fifth fastest times. McRae, on the other hand, was clearly beginning to dominate and pushed the Impreza to its limits. At Pantberthog and Garth Eniog, he was fastest in both stages. On Dovey Main, only Malcolm Wilson was faster. Between the Scot and the Finn, the gap was closing. It was a day of massive improvement for Malcolm Wilson, growing in confidence and happily free of the mechanical problems that had followed him all season. The veteran Harry Vatanen came to grief on stage 14 when he left the road, losing some 3 minutes, damaging the front of his Subaru and dropping from fourth to eighth. Swede Mats Jonsson's consistency kept him firmly in the top 10, but still 6 minutes off the pace. Robbie Head in his Ford Escort Cosworth moved up to 10th, despite losing around 30 seconds after a spin close to the end of stage 14. Once again, the Welsh fans turned out for their old man, Gwyndaf Evans. He's come to grief on home territory in previous years, but this time, things were working better for him. Sebastian Lindholm, the Finn, showed that drivers sometimes have to double up as mechanics, an impromptu wheel change in front of our cameras. If there was a prize for streaking through the field, Paul Kirtley in his Ford would be in the running, jumping into the top 20 from a starting position of 59. While most people were watching the battle at the top of the leaderboard, Jeremy Easton was pleasing his fans, holding 16th place overall. He was being chased by this man, Stephen Fetch, in another Ford. Mad Mick Jones was in one of his more subdued moods, moving to 20th place overall on this his home rally.
Yes, well played there, Mad Mick. Well, the good news for Britain is that Colin McRae hauled in Kankanen as darkness fell in the forests of Wales later this afternoon. By the end of the last stage, he was 21 seconds ahead. Malcolm Wilson also kept up the momentum in those latter stages. Now, a short time ago, Tony Mason caught up with those happy Brits.
Everyone's been saying how terrible the conditions were. I mean, how did you find them compared to anything else you've done?
Yeah, they are. It's just the first stage this morning and some of them today have just been like ice rinks. It's a lottery, really. I mean, it's not a test of driving skill at all. It's just pure luck who stays on the road and who doesn't.
So, are you looking forward to the stages tomorrow in the Lake District?
Yeah, I'm looking forward to getting to the end of Grisdale anyway.
I mean, it's not a bad position to be in third as you come out of Wales, is it?
No, it's. If you'd asked me that before the start, I think I'd have been quite happy with that. I wasn't happy with the performance on Sunday, but today's gone relatively well. Quite steady. I think, you know, they had spin and that like everybody else, but we've managed to survive. But, I mean, the conditions are just unbelievable.
Really haven't been as bad as everyone's been talking about it. It's amazing.
I mean, it's just, I can't believe it, really. I mean, it's just, you sit there and you're just waiting for things to happen. You're waiting for the bang and you turn the steering wheel and nothing happens. You brake and it just goes, the car goes quicker. You know, you've got to use all the road, all the ditches, and you're always running at risk of doing more damage to the car, you know, by hitting a rock or something that's hidden. I mean, I know we swerved in there to miss one, and I mean, I just missed it by so much, but I mean, if it hit it, it would probably have took the front suspension off.
So that's the position that, after stage 19, Colin McRae in the Subaru in the lead. Great news for British rallying. Kankanen in second spot in his Toyota. Malcolm Wilson up there also of Britain in his Ford. Ericsson in the Mitsubishi, Francois Delacour in the Ford, Oriel in the Toyota, and Richard Burns. That's it from me on the day Britain's Colin McRae took over the lead of the rally. We'll be back later on, but for now, good night.